Hey everybody, it's Mark Oakley here again with another episode of From the Drawing Board, and today I wanted to continue my my little series, which is starting with episode one about the CIA. Now, I'd mentioned in my last video that I've been doing some revisiting of old books that I'd read, and one of them is right here. It's, see if you can see that. Here, The Secret Team. This is a monster book, and it's a pretty important book. I haven't heard anyone really talking about it much, but this thing is written by Fletcher Prouty. And, oh, it's got a foreword by Jesse Ventura. I didn't see that until I just looked at it now. Goodness. Which one did he write? It doesn't, it's not signed. It's just the foreword just ends. Let's see here. Maybe it's got his name in there. Yep, Jesse Ventura. In his famous farewell address, President Eisenhower warned of something new in our political landscape. He's just asking questions. The military-industrial complex. Just a short little thing. The first time I read this book, I can't even remember how I came across it. It was, I saw a recommendation for it somewhere, and I thought, okay, I should read that book. Because out of the many, many books I've read about sort of how the world works behind the veil of, I don't know, normalcy, a couple stood out in terms of the intelligence community. There's a lot of stuff. There's a lot of parts to the unseen world, but intelligence, CIA, secret organizations, they make up a piece of that. It's an important piece. And out of that bunch of information, there were two books that stood out, one of which was this one that Fletcher Prouty wrote. The other one I'll talk about a bit later. It covers a later period, which is just as important and as revealing. And it's, just an excellent, excellent book. This one, Fletcher Prouty's, was covering the period of his work in the CIA from the 50s, mid-50s to the mid-60s. So this 10-year period where he was like right in the thick of it and seeing some big world-shaking events take place and being right at the top of it and being very upset by what he saw. And so you get this early, photograph of or a picture of the CIA. And when he wrote the book, it originally came out in the very early 70s, I think 1972 or something like that. I could look it up, but it's right in that sort of area. And I managed to get a copy, I think it was like a second edition of that book. And you can't find, well, you can find it. I wanted to get the original that I'd read because I remember reading it and thinking, I want to quote this thing to someone. I was just talking about this. He said this really neat thing and I can't remember it. I should look it up again. And that book's not in my library anymore because I lent it to someone. It's just gone. That happens. I explained in the last video how that's a feature of my library. So stuff is always revolving. It's a very healthy, there's not a lot of swamp slime that grows on my library because all the good stuff is in, processed, and out again. So I'll just buy another copy. So I found this one. This is the only one you can get. And it's a lot longer, and it came out, it was published, this was in the 90s, I think. Let me just double check, see where this came from. So this was printed in copyright 2011. Wow, this came out many, many years later than the first one. 1972, 72, 82, 92, 30 years later, man. And so he had another chance to sort of take a crack at it and add stuff. It's like 200 pages longer. Oh, let me bring up a picture. This is the picture of the cover of the first one. Boof, there it is, The Secret Team. There's a copy on eBay for like, this is a cheap one. It was only $200. You can get first editions for $400 or $500. I'm like, I'm not spending that much money just to get a keepsake. So I found this at a garage sale or a used bookstore somewhere, bought it, read it, thought it was wonderful, didn't value it for what it was, and just lent it some, and it's gone. Now, I remember reading the second edition, and Fletcher Prouty wrote in his own foreword, this was some of his experience after the first edition came out. And there were some crazy stories, surrounding it, because it was not very long after when this was published, after some of the events that he was writing about. And some of those were still pretty prickly and thorny and painful for some of the players involved. They were still in the game, you know. And so he said, well, he was too high up, too well connected to sort of be killed, because that sort of thing is absolutely a part of the secret team. But he did say that, you know, within about a week, every copy was just gone. All the warehouses had been wiped out. All of the, when I say wiped out, mysterious buyers had bought up all the stock, and it was just gone. All the bookshops had been cleaned out. Everywhere where these books had been distributed to were just cleaned out. So if you happened to buy a copy during that period, you were lucky, because, you know, 90% of the run was just removed from circulation. By who? We don't know. Obviously, it was a CIA agent saying, well, we don't want this message getting out there. However, I think there was an element in the CIA at the time that was very sympathetic towards Prouty's view, because as you learn when reading through this, you discover that there really is a schizophrenic nature to not just the CIA, but to the American military establishment in general. You've got, people who, you know, their job. I know a guy, you know, he works at one of the Air Force bases up here. He can't tell me what he does. Works on aircraft, you know, and it's, but, you know, there's all these things that he can't talk about. He's a really good guy. You know, he is wonderful around the community. He's well-liked, and he's not going to be attached to friggin' Epstein Island stuff, you know, but that's also a part of the CIA because it's got this dual nature. And and so I feel like this message was allowed to come out because he wasn't just being the CIA is evil. He was critical of some of the directions that had gone and how it was working in opposition to its own stated purpose, which is sort of protecting the world, the free world, right? So anyway, I wanted to read that intro again because that was one of the most exciting parts. It's kind of like when I used to buy, you know, comic books back in the day, the before the internet, and you'd read the letter sections in the back, and that was, we didn't have Facebook, and we were perhaps luckier back then, but we didn't even have email. We didn't have social media to compare and contrast our views with other readers of like mind. And so often you'd buy a comic book and you'd flip immediately to, I want to know what the editors have to say. I want to know what the readers have to say. That was very, very exciting because that was the most immediate form of social media we had. It was on paper. It came out once a month, you know? And I felt the same way about the foreword that Fletcher Prouty had written, because it was, hey, this is my immediate experience in dealing with this subject. The book is the meal, but this is the appetizer, and you just, I want the appetizer right away. So anyway, that's what I was reading. So I wanted to give a brief overview of, I guess I can break this into three parts. First of all, I want to start like, why am I doing this? Why am I suddenly interested? Because that's an interesting question right now. Two is, what exactly is this CIA monolith and how does it work? Because I guarantee it's very, very different from how we've perceived the intelligence community all these years from the perspective of most people in the public. It's a radically different arrangement, and it's really, really interesting. So I want to talk about that. That'll be sort of part two. And then I wanted to talk about little incidental stories from within. Like, there's this term that Fletcher Prouty would use called sheep dipping. And that's like, sheep, what, you dipping sheep? What does that mean? And it's a process of masking the identities of agents. And it's got multiple levels, which expands into this just brilliant story and explanation for why the CIA is untrackable and untraceable, and how deeply embedded everything has become. And that's a whole neat thing, that term and other little stories like that. So that'd be sort of a part three. So first of all, let's get into the why. People who've been reading my comics will have noted that I'm dealing with a storyline right now which is all about intelligence gathering and secret influence exerted over the world by Quentin. I've got this wizard who you know, has his own intelligence apparatus. And I've been thinking about this for quite some, for months now, months and months, and writing this story. And you can see, here's a page where he's inside his big, one of the organs of his vast intelligence gathering system. And it's, you can't quite see, where do I have, I didn't draw it for this page, but there's pipes and, you know, listening tubes and little goggles, because there is a period in that history where optical, you know, technology had sort of risen to a point where you could capitalize on it before it sank back down into the depths. Wonder why, Quentin. And that's a very poor little sketchy drawing of one of the things. It was just in comics, often you'll draw that establishing shot where you just go all out and you draw every little nut and bolt and pipe, and then you're like, well, I can't draw that dozens of times. Although I've done a fair bit of that, but at this point in the conversation, it's about to wrap up. I'm just like, I'm done drawing that crazy machine. Everyone gets it. Let's just put sort of an icon for what it is. We all recognize that thing, but that's a hyper simplized version of just a corner of this whole thing. But why? Why did I get into this now? Because thoughts about this have been sort of marching through my mind, and I decided at a certain point I want to research this to make sure that it fits with there's an ethical, not dilemma. I want to make my stories as fanciful and silly and sort of lighthearted as they are. If I am going to be brushing up against a topic like, you know, intelligence gathering or secret intelligence, espionage, then I want all the little points that are brought up in a cartoon way to resonate with things that are real. So even though you get sort of a caricature of the real thing, you are still coming away with an accurate impression of the real patterns that work in the world. And the best way to do that is just research. That's what makes stories good, in my opinion, is when people have this mind full of real knowledge. And so when they tell a story, they can tap that and make little in-jokes and fit the patterns together in a way that works on the page, which, you know, is accurate to reality. So that's sort of my motivation there. But that's still not answering the question, like, why? I could have taken this story in multiple directions. I just did a swashbuckling scene prior to this. Why not more of that? Why not, you know, look at magic? Why not any number of storylines that I could have followed? But why this? And I think it's because my subconscious, I've talked about this many times, is plugged into the world net of subconscious. And for probably very rational reasons, people are becoming aware of the lies behind the activities going on in the world today. I don't know how this has affected you, but as media and stories have become very propaganda driven and very the message driven, I've lost interest in new movies. And not just because of that, I think that's a parallel development, but I find that I just don't read fiction as much. I don't watch movies as much. If a TV series comes on, I'm sort of, maybe I'll get to it. I mean, not even very many years ago, I get very, very excited about, The Mandalorian, this new Star Wars thing. I'm super invested. I want to watch that, but not anymore. And I think part of it is definitely the quality drop and the problems with Lucasfilm. But also because I feel like stories and our fascination with stories was a preparation for the kinds of times that we're living through now. They're sort of, you're through virtual reality learning hard lessons in multiple directions and many, many different layers. You're trying to learn how the functions of good and evil, for instance, that's a big focus in most movies. There's a villain, there's a bad guy, there's a good guy, there's a hero. How does that work? What are the relationships? Just get that massive sample data so that when it comes, when push comes to shove, you've got a mythological lore baked into your head that you can draw upon for quick answers, for quickly understanding things that are really going on. And the things really going on today are kind of critical. There's a lot of big things happening. And I find that the thing that has become fun, because I think fun is the body and brain's response to fulfilling an important need, like, oh, you got to learn about this, make it feel fun, and that way we can survive by learning directly through play. Fun right now is watching news and watching the developments in culture and watching the developments in politics and how all of these things interrelate. That's far more interesting than watching the latest Marvel movie, which, even if they were really good, I'm sort of like, yeah, this is not a bad film, but I want to get back to the YouTube subscription list and see what's been going on with the latest real stories, because that has become more engaging than everything else. And so I think that's an interesting facet. I don't know if I'm the only one. Maybe a lot of people feel that way, but fiction just doesn't do it for me the same way reality does. And that's interesting. So in looking at reality, and I guess my writing will reflect my experiences with reality, so maybe that's why I'm exploring writing stories about espionage, because espionage and secret covert psychological operations are such a big part of our reality today. So it's bleeding into my stories, and hopefully my stories can help illuminate to myself and to people who read it a little bit about what's going on. I wouldn't recommend trying to find the answers to big questions by reading my work. This is a gentle diversion, which will sort of keep you on track at best. And like much media, it's just I'm part of a dying breed, I think. Comics are just, comics used to be the important, one of the important driving movers for those reasons I was describing, like the big preparation for dealing with reality. And now it's moving on to something else, and that's fair, but it's always good to have a nice distraction, especially if it's done with passion, which is how I keep the passion here. Is I look at reality and get excited about it and write about it as I see it, or let it affect my work. The other thing I've noticed is that other people are also beginning to pull back the covers. There are a lot of people questioning how the news media portrays world events. And well, that's clearly not true according to what I know about these other things and what on the ground reporters say. Like, there's so many lies floating around. How can that be? How can so many people be lying so consistently in certain directions? And what's the deal with that? And we've been asking that. We've been noticing it. We've been frustrated by it for a long time. And now we're beginning to come to some conclusions. And I think, and I've seen, as I'm like, oh, I'm going to do this little series on the CIA, I'm noticing that same theme popping up. And it might just be pattern recognition, but I don't think it is. I think it's an effect of people being plugged into the same question. Like, we're all part of the human race, and we're all watching the same vast real story of reality unfold, and these questions are going to occur to us in concert. It's not a magical system. It's just how brains work, and I feel like the Earth is one big brain that we're all little lobes of. So yeah, I'm definitely noticing other people discussing secrecy and how it works and why it works. And so this is my little response to that little nudge in the brain. This is something that's worth talking about, worth exploring. And so yeah, my reaction was to A, write about it. It's in pulling stories out of the dreamscape of my mind, and then wonder, am I getting this right? And revisiting what I know, and rereading these books, and rereading old books that you were affected by, years later, is really, really cool. It's been a great experience. There's so much stuff that I forgot. And it's almost like the first reading sows the field or puts down all the raw material. And the second time you go through it, it kind of sorts it and crystallizes things and allows things to take shape. So there's been a lot of revelations. The second book I read, I don't have a physical copy. I gave that one away too. Or it might be packed up downstairs. I don't know which, but I have a PDF of it. In reading through that, it was laying out a lot of the actions happening in the Middle East with regard to fundamentalist Muslim terrorism and how that came to be. And it mentions the Uyghur Muslims in China and what that's all about, and how the CIA was using this tool to create, to shift power in emerging states, so that they're always kind of on edge, never could coalesce power. And some of the tactics are really, really interesting because they match, they line up with some of the tactics going on in North America now. And when you see the sort of have like a blueprint, like, okay, here's what we did, here's how we did it, here's the effect, here's how it blew up in our face, and here's how it was effective for a while before it blew up in our face. And it's playbook stuff, and it's not conspiracy theories like, this is what we did, here's how we did it. And you know, when you have like a really good political writer, F. William, I can't remember the fellow's name. Why do these writers all have funny names? I can't answer that. But I'll talk about that second book another time. But that was a really interesting one where you read through that and you're going, oh, okay, before when I read this, I was just trying to understand things like 9/11 and the war in Iraq and the war in Afghanistan. And now from a more distant view, you can understand, oh, there's the machinations behind that. They didn't stop there. They're moving into phase whatever, you know, and it's affecting the West. And the same playbook systems are being used. And it was just like, oh, I get it. It's so clear. Maybe that's a part three or part four to this little series. Anyway, that's I'm going to wrap this up. And we will catch up with you in another video with part two. All right. Thanks for tuning in. Love you all. Hope you have a wonderful day or evening wherever you are. And we'll see you again soon. Bye.